everyone, and welcome to our podcast, Smart Man, Smarter Woman, a podcast for entrepreneurs by entrepreneurs. And thank you for joining us today. I am Steve Lotz.
And I am Juliet Aurora.
And we are your co-hosts. But before I introduce today's guest, let's hear just a few words from my wonderful co-host, that smarter woman herself, Juliet. How are you doing today, Juliet?
I am excellent, thank you. And you know, you're going to actually build this up where you keep introducing me as the smarter woman herself, that, you know, it's going to be tough for me to keep living up to that legacy that you're creating.
Oh, I see. And I'm not sure I agree, because smarter is a relative thing. And I am saying smarter relative to me. And I don't think you will ever have a problem living up to that. And that's why this works, right? We're not being arrogant. It's all a relative thing when we say smart man, smarter woman.
Okay.
I'm smarter than a rock, and you're smarter than me.
Perfect.
It's good.
So I get to be smarter than a rock. I love it. Okay. I can handle that.
Absolutely. So anyway, as you all know, with every episode, we try to provide you with some entertainment, hopefully, but most importantly, some value, some insights, some gold nuggets, as we call them, to help you on your own entrepreneurial journey, wherever you may be on that journey. And today we have a great show for you, and with a very special guest, Rebecca Mountain. Rebecca is a certified high-performance coach, a social marketing strategist, and her mission, which is a huge mission, I got to admit, and we got to jump into this as we get into the podcast. Her mission is to help as many people as possible live happy, rich, and fulfilled lives. So, wow. So let's bring our guest into the show, Rebecca Mountain. Welcome, Rebecca, and thank you for joining us all the way from the thriving metropolis of Burlington, Ontario.
A local. Awesome.
I'm a local. Woo-hoo! Yes. Thank you. It's great to be here, guys. I love chatting with you guys. I always have over the years. So thank you for having me on your podcast today.
Oh, our pleasure. Glad you could join us. We know you're very busy. I won't ask you to repeat how busy you are.
No, you have to. You have to get her to repeat how busy she was.
Okay.
That was a great response.
Rebecca,
how busy are you?
I'm busier, as I've mentioned before, busier than a one-armed monkey in a bag of bananas. So yes, that's a very very poignant metaphor.
I love that.
Absolutely. I do. That's great. And I'm really looking forward to our conversation today. Full disclosure, we have known Rebecca for a few years, as she mentioned. We are based in Burlington, for those of you that didn't know that. And we've actually used Rebecca's services and worked with her in the past. But the reason we invited her here today is to share her amazing story, because she has lots, but she also, I know, is going to have lots of great insights that will benefit those of you listening. So I really am excited to have her join us here today. So maybe to kick things off, perhaps, Rebecca, if you could take a few minutes and just share a little of your story and your own entrepreneurial journey that sort of got you to where you are right now.
Sure. Well, the journey is rather meandering, so I hope you're in for a bit of a whirlwind ride in the Coles Notes version. For any Americans listening, this would be the Cliff Notes version. I've reminded myself many times that I have no idea what Coles Notes means. So my entrepreneurial journey started in 2010, and it started because I got fired from my corporate job for the third time. So not the same job, different job. So I considered myself the world's worst employee and decided that the only person who could not fire me was me. So off I went with two small kids and no idea what I was going to do. Actually, I really didn't know. And so back in 2010, social media was still new, and I went around and I just inquired of rather different businesses, like, what is your biggest problem? And this is one thing, just sort of like, you know, I'm going to filter in a few little tidbits of what I learned along the way. And one of the things I learned was understand the problem you're serving. So I learned this just by random chance, because I was trying not to starve to death. And I found out that social media was really difficult for people. And so, fun fact, I built an entire social media agency, which over the years grew to about 1 million in sales, having never used Facebook before. So I taught myself, and all I needed to be was one step ahead of everybody else. And as long as I could maintain that and continue to learn and to strive to improve my programs, I would be okay. So I started off as a consultant teaching real estate agents, actually, how to do social media. I just happened to know them. I went after three industries. So this, again, for anyone trying to figure out their niche, I went after wineries because we're close to the winery district. I went after construction because I had some experience there. And I went after realtors. So what I learned was wineries, bless their souls, have two seasons, no money and no time. I would have absolutely starved to death if I'd gone after construction because they take a glacial pace to making decisions, at least the ones I went after. But real estate agents were like contractors. They made their own decisions. And on a one-to-one basis, they could choose to work with me. So I just really kind of hit it up there. And then that became my niche. So I'm not a realtor, but I worked with them for the past 10 years. Certified at the Toronto Real Estate Board. I've taught internationally to various real estate brokerages and associations. And so I took that consulting job and I just expanded it into speaking, training, teaching. And then my path started to diverge. I decided to hire a series of coaches. And what I quickly realized was that didn't work. So that just for a whole bunch of reasons, that model was not suited for me. I like to do the coaching myself. Managing a team of coaches is very, very different. So whenever an entrepreneur says, okay, I want to scale, make sure that your scaling model is within your strength wheelhouse. Or if it's not, again, one of the lessons I learned was get someone for whom it is and have that person manage that portion of the organization. But I was young and learning and failing forward. So I moved that to the side. Mostly because I got frustrated that the people who I was coaching weren't taking my advice, which for most coaches is super frustrating. So I decided to build a marketing agency and do it for people. And that's where we worked together a number of years ago, scaled that up to over $1 million a year. And yet I was miserable. I worked 90 hours a week. I had a team of 14, great team, but it was not something that was really fulfilling me. So even though everything else in my life was great, I felt like there was something missing. It's like a weight that weighted me down. And so what I discovered was that I had screwed up a very important equation. And this is one that most entrepreneurs screw up. And that is the balance between income and impact. I have been chasing the almighty dollar. And I got that almighty dollar. And yet the work that I did not feel, again, this is just for me, I did not feel that it was really solving problems for people. So I could run amazing ads and great emails and generate thousands of leads for people. But what I soon realized is that even though I could drive all the stuff into their funnels, their systems and their mindsets were all messed up. And so they couldn't close them. They couldn't turn them into sales. So it became a revolving door. They'd come in, I'd generate leads, they would become overwhelmed, and they would leave. So 2 years ago, I went on a search as to how can I resolve this issue? And I came across high performance coaching. And I loved it so much because I went through it and it completely altered my way of looking at the world. And that's where I came out with that phrase you mentioned at the beginning, to help people live happier, wealthier, more fulfilled lives, because I missed all three of those things. And I was determined to not only create that for myself, but in the spirit of learn and help learn, to push that out into the world. So now as a high performance coach, I do one-on-one coaching, I do group coaching, I have membership programs and courses, all designed around helping people to overcome whatever is blocking them from really not only achieving their goals. You don't have to be a millionaire to be wealthy. You may feel that you just want to be able to pay your bills and go on vacation without worrying. You may want to have richer, more meaningful connections with people. That's what I strive for now. And so the journey that I was on, I took that equation that for probably 8 years, I had in the wrong order of income versus impact, flipped it on its head, and I decided that I would do something that would have such incredible impact that the income would simply follow. I no longer chase money. I don't chase success. I don't chase clients. I do what I need to do that would push out what I know into the world that attracts the right people for whom that message resonates and who are ready for change. And I engage them in whichever aspect of the business works, not only for the results they want, but also for their pocketbook.
Great. I love that statement, learn and help learn, that you said, where you actually went through the process yourself, learned it, experienced mm-hmm. it and are now helping others go through that similar transformation that you went through. I love that statement.
Thanks. Yeah, I totally stole it from a book. Fun fact, or full disclosure, it's from the book Mindset by Carol Dweck. She's actually mentioned in the book that I wrote called Think Again, which was my 7-stage journey from self-sabotage to success. So it incorporates that journey, but plus I grew up in a cultish kind of religion, so I had to break out of that kind of stuff. So the learn, help, learn is actually under what Carol calls the growth mindset. And the fixed mindset, which is where we all have both, but we strive to limit the fixed mindset stuff. The way that you phrase that is judge and be judged. And so for entrepreneurs, many of us can stay in that fixed mindset. We compare ourselves to others. We are afraid of falling behind. We're afraid of losing customers. We're afraid of running out of money, afraid, afraid, afraid. And we give ourselves labels and stuff that we use to say, well, this is who I am and I cannot be different. When really it's you're simply untrained. And if you take on, say, okay, well, I'm going to move from judge and be judged to learn and help learn, you say, okay, what is it that I'm trying to move away from? What trauma, big T, small T, have I experienced, bad things I've gone through, to say, how do I take that, learn something from it, apply it, and then teach it? And that's where you really know you've made serious growth, is when you're able to actually teach people what you have done and use your story as a launch pad for not only for yourself to remind you where you've been, but also where you're going, but then to inspire others to do the same.
That's great.
So one thing I'd like to ask you about your story. So you built your agency, which is where we worked with you.
That's right.
You had a team of 14 and mm-hmm. you pivoted and mm-hmm. changed completely. That must have been terrifying.
Yes.
Because you had something that worked and that was successful, mm-hmm. you know, in terms of, you know, societal definition of success. Mm-hmm. For you to say, well, you know, I'm not being fulfilled. It's not filling what I need. I'm going to change it. And you had no idea whether this new thing that you wanted to do was going to get you anywhere, was going to be able to pay your bills and look after your kids and look after your family.
No idea.
Can you kind of walk us through why you made that decision? Because it was obviously a really difficult decision to make.
Mm-hmm. I made the decision because I woke up every day hating what I did. I didn't want to get out of bed. My phone was lava. I was frustrated with the work. I was frustrated with the revolving door of clients, frustrated I couldn't fix that, and could not foresee having that same business running in perpetuity and me not wanting to like jump off a cliff. I grew up in a very restricted life. So just to give you a series of what my life was like, if you've ever watched The Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt, where she comes out of a bunker and then, you know, experiences life, I'm Kimmy minus the bunker. So when I grew up, we had no TV, no radio. I'm a classically trained pianist because I wasn't really encouraged to play other stuff. There was no prom, no sleepovers, no friends at school, no makeup, no jewelry, no parties of any kind. But I'm trying to make sure I've covered everything here. As I grew older, of course, no alcohol. And we're not encouraged to even communicate with people outside of the religion. So it was very, very insular. We have the right idea. Everyone else is cooked. So, you know, stay inside and don't question. By all means, don't question. If you do, you're going to die of cancer or car crash. That was a favorite. And so when I did actually roll my car on the QEW 6-lane highway at 6:30 in the morning, you know, skidding at 70 kilometers an hour with my car crushed above me against my steering wheel with the pavement an inch from my eyeballs. And I got out of it completely unscathed and I realized they were wrong. And they were wrong about everything. And so from that moment on, I've just blew up my life. And, you know, and we've already heard my journey. So because I had lived a restricted life, a life where I was unhappy, where I looked in the mirror and I barely recognized who I was seeing because of how gray that I felt, I wasn't doing the things I loved. And I was just really feeling that, you know, you just want to run away from your life. And I was getting to that again. I was getting back to that. So here I am, free as a bird, remarried to the most beautiful man in the world, 4 amazing kids, everything that I could have ever wanted. And yet I'm feeling that restriction, that love, that level of unhappiness and of not knowing what to do about it. So it was to such a degree that I recognized, no matter how painful that this was going to be, that it was going to be worth it in the end. And I had believed in myself enough to that point and I could believe in myself again. I'm a creator. I am a doer, and I love to help people. If I could have gone back to myself 20 years ago, I would have given myself so much advice to avoid the pain that I went through. And so it was a throat grabbing, throttling feeling of saying impact over income. And I would sit at my desk and I'm like, impact over income, Rebecca, you've got this. Impact over income. Don't worry about the money. Worry about the work that you do and the change that it brings. And, you know, it will come. I am blessed to have a husband who supported me through this. So as my income went to zero, you know, we'd had some savings and he was just, you know, you've got this. I believe that you're going to move this. So having that support was critical. And I feel for people who don't have that. And as a coach, I try to step in that way and to let them know they have a support. And then I teach them how to support themselves, right? So sometimes it starts external before we can internalize because we put up walls, right? So I break those down. So that path, that decision I made that enough is enough and I refuse to be miserable for the rest of my life, and I would choose happiness. I choose fulfillment and I choose to be successful every day and to look at success not as a size of my bank account or how many clients. Success is, did I make a contribution today? So every day I go into the day and I end my day with the one question, did I do work that mattered? Did I make someone happier, wealthier, or more fulfilled today?
We will continue with our conversation right after this message from a friend of the show. AIS Solutions is an award-winning cloud accounting firm serving small business all across Canada. If you want to migrate to a powerful and effective paperless accounting system and get your financials wherever you are, whenever you want them, then contact AIS Solutions team of trained professionals today at www.aissolutions.ca. And now, back to our conversation.
And it has to hit one of those three things. And I don't go to bed until I have. I do not put my head on the pillow until I have done something. And it can be something as small as sending a text of appreciation. It could be something as big as closing a $1 million client, right? So no matter how great or small, did I do something? Did I do work that mattered to me? Did I do work that makes a difference for someone else? What I consider the hockey stick. So Darren Hardy's book, Compound Effect, is one that is a very short book, but a very impactful book. You do the things you know that if you do them consistently, will bring the business. And there's a delay. So you have to start doing those things. So for me, it's training. So every week, starting in January, I'm like, okay, 2020 is going to be my year. You may notice there's been a pandemic. That was interesting. But in January, I didn't know this pandemic was coming. I should have. We should have figured that out. But I said, if I do a training every week, then that is what's going to bring the clients and the clients will bring the money. So I'm not going to chase the money. I'm going to chase the actions that I can control that will produce those results. And so again, so as a lesson for entrepreneurs, you can be scattered doing so many different things. But what I try to get people to do is what comes naturally to you. What if you could do it consistently, whether it's every day or every week, whatever frequency it needs to happen for you to grow your business at the speed you want to grow it, you do that thing and you do it over and over. You run that webinar, even if one person is there. You do that workshop, even if two people show up. You do all this stuff because you know but the compound effect of all your efforts will, again, hockey stick the results at the end. And that's exactly what happened. So I've gone from zero to, oh, heck, I need another team because now I've got too many clients. I've got too much work. I'm brokering a $1 million deal in the US for exclusive training because they know it makes a difference. I have no competition for that. So I know I'm going to get it. Just pandemics tend to drag things on a little bit, but that's okay. I can be patient because I know what I need to do in order to continue my business at such a level that I can make as much money as I want.
Lots of great advice in that.
Yeah.
Series of sentences there. I'm not even sure what to
put. Yeah, no, that was terrific. First of all, I would like to congratulate you on your courage. The courage it took to take that first step. And that takes courage. I don't care what anybody says to be able to do that. Mm. So congratulations. I'd like to come back to the coaching and I'd like to come back to it from this perspective. Juliet and I are huge fans of coaching. We believe it should be mandatory for every entrepreneur.
Yep.
If not a coach, then a mentor, a mastermind group, something to help you. Mm-hmm. Now, if I go back 10 years, maybe 12 years, I didn't feel that way. At that point in my life, I had had what I thought was a successful business for a number of years. Successful in terms of making money and the material toys. But like you, I reached a point where I certainly wasn't happy doing it. And so a lot of things happened. Juliet and I decided we wanted to try to take her business, which she had started on her own way back in the year 2000, and build it into a business. And so we did that. We started hiring people. And literally, I won't say we fell on our face, but it was close.
We fell on our face.
And so
we did.
Okay. Yeah. And so around 2011, I guess now, we reached a point where we started talking about closing the business. And what were we going to do if we did that? And what was our life going to look like? And were we going to be okay with it? And because of our personalities, no, we weren't going to be okay with it. And so we decided, after much discussion and bottles of wine, that we were going to look into hiring a coach. This was very, very hard for my ego. That why would I possibly need a coach when I'd had this business, which I later on found out wasn't a business. It was simply a job I created for myself. But that's a whole other story. Anyway, I will get to my question eventually. My question is this. What would you say to those entrepreneurs out there who are really struggling and yet the thought of a coach, they're not at that point. They're not at the point where, yes, the coach is the answer. The answer is, I just need to work harder. I need to work longer hours. I just need more clients. What would you say to them to help them reach the decision it took me 20 years to reach, that they don't have to go through that 20 years?
Yeah, so I was there very much. If I work harder, I will get to where I want to go. My answer to that is sort of twofold. So in the first case, the most successful people know how to do one thing exceptionally well. They ask. They ask for help. They ask for what they want. They are relentless in what Ray Dalio calls candid open-mindedness, which means they take their ideas to people who they know maybe have different perspectives, and they conversationally argue about it, not because not fight about it, but you test and challenge for the purpose of saying, like, am I really right? Really, really right. And so I also stalled at getting a coach for 5 years. Started in 2010. I can do this myself. I'm a smart girl. I know how to do this. I can learn. I can make money. I can grow and be successful. But what you fail to understand is that you're an island. You are one person with one group of thoughts, with one group of ideas. When you add another person who is as excited about life and business as you are, but has a completely different perspective, it's 1 + 1 = 5. And so back in, I think it was 6 or 7 years ago now, I got my first coach and I realized something very important. I could go at my own pace. And let's say, you know, it's like a 1, 2, 3. If I get a coach, it's 1, 5, 10, because they bring a different perspective. They challenge you in new ways. They open up your mind to new thoughts that no matter what, you can't have on your own. You don't know everything. Asking for help is the sign of a succeeder, not of a failure, not of I don't know enough, so I'm stupid. And that's what the problem is with a lot of people when it comes to coaching. I have failed. I am deficient. And that's why I need a coach. You should get a coach when you're already, you know, you're kind of turning up the dial and you're like, I can do more, but you need to know how to do more better. Like, don't reinvent the wheel. That's the stupidest thing in the world. And there are so many experts out there now that we have access to, even more than when I was going and starting my business 10 years ago. So if I can go to someone and say, okay, I want to do, say, a webinar. I want to do a whole webinar funnel. I'll do the webinar, but I want you to do all the automation and the emails, and because you know what? You just know how to do it better. Sure, I could do it, but I don't want to, right? Nor should I, because they'll do it better than me, which means I go from zero to the results I'm looking for at Mach 2 speed, as opposed to a little turtle, right? So that's one perspective on coaching. The other perspective on coaching and why it's so important and why the nose to the grindstone, hustle, hustle, hustle does nothing but burn people out and overwhelm them is because of the way that we go about acting. So when we see a goal, entrepreneurs that haven't gone through the process of understanding how actions relate to what we believe in ourselves will just work really, really hard. But it's like you're stuck in the mud and your wheels are spinning. And the wheels are spinning because you can say, my goal is to make 100,000 a year or 1 million a year or to get so many clients or to do whatever, like whatever the goal is, monetary or otherwise. If, however, you do not truly believe that you can get there, do not believe that you deserve that, cannot picture yourself in that position, you cannot act counter to what you believe in. And it acts like basically an anchor to a wall. And you can work as hard as you want, but if your belief system is counter to what you are striving to achieve, you cannot move ahead. So part of what I teach and part of what my book was all about is back that train up two stations. Your belief system is made up of thoughts thought often enough. So if you think I'm not good enough, I'm not smart enough, I'm worse than my peers, or whatever the thoughts are that you say about yourself or that you compare yourself to others, assumptions you make, you need to turn those around. Instead of saying I'm not good enough, I'm more than enough, right? Even if you don't believe it at first, because you won't, because neurologically, you got to build new paths. It's neuroscience. It's not woo-woo stuff. It's literally your brain and how, you know, different neural pathways are created. So you got to carve new pathways, and that takes time and repetition. So that's why mantras are important. I take sticky notes and I put them all over the place for what I'm trying to achieve. Because as I think those things, through reticular activation system in your brain, your brain's like, oh, you want me to show you proof that you're smart. See, because you just kept telling yourself that you're stupid. So I was just showing you that you're stupid. Now you want to switch gears and you want me to show you proof in the world that you're smart. Well, let me do that. Because our brain can't focus on everything, so it focuses on what we feed into it. So you do that often enough, carves new neural pathway, builds a new belief system. And then what happens is you work half as much and get twice as far. So you don't start with working yourself to death. You start with, what do I really believe? And is there anything in there that can hold me back? And if there is, back that train up one station to the thoughts. What thoughts am I thinking every day? And how do I replace those? How do I remind myself? How do I, you know, you put something on your phone, you put a sticky on your mirror as you're brushing your teeth and you read that over and over again. I had a sticky on mine that said, I wanted to be on stage with Brendan Burchard and Dean Graziosi. Two people that books I've read that I thought were absolutely fantastic started me on this journey. And I didn't know how that was going to happen. I didn't know what that was going to look like, but I put that up there. And every day I fed my brain that information. Within 6 months, I was on stage with Brendan, having graduated from his certification program. And we had a little chat about the program and, you know, so that kind of a thing. And that was what on stage with Brendan Burchard looked like. But he knew who I was, and I, you know, was now going to be able to launch a whole new career for myself that was going to change my life. For Dean Graziosi, he and Tony Robbins came up with the Knowledge Business Blueprint, and I got wind of it early. And so I used it, I loved it, and I was part of their $30 million launch because they had me do a video that they showed during their live telecast to raise $30 million for that Knowledge Business Blueprint. So technically, that was my stage. And when you feed your brain things like that, you think, how on earth is that going to happen? It doesn't matter how it happens. It matters that you believe it will. And then you let that go.
Yeah.
We're both speechless.
Lots there.
And that is speechless, which never happens, right? Usually one or other or the other of us. So you talked about so many different things in there about how it's our brain and our mindset and what we tell ourselves mm-hmm. that's going to dictate where we go and what direction mm-hmm. we go. Can you touch on a couple of things? You touched on one there about getting yourself unstuck as a business owner to move to the next level. Is there anything else that you see over and over and over again as to how business owners are holding themselves back? Or is it primarily just their belief system and what they're thinking?
Most often, it's a belief system. They are smart. They are capable. In most cases, they know what they should be doing, but they get into these self-sabotage cycles. So for instance, I'll give you an example. A client of mine, brilliant woman, been in her industry for 20 years. And every morning, she wakes up a failure. And she wakes up a failure because for, I think it was like 20 years or something like that, she's been trying to get up at 7 o'clock, but she always blows past it. And she's usually up at like 7:45 or whatever, but every morning when she wakes up, she starts her day feeling like she has already failed. And so that's self-sabotage, right? That's someone who has gotten so used to feeling bad about themselves is they create these habits that reinforce that feeling of failure. So you can imagine the easiest flip in the world. You know what I told her to do? Say you're going to get up at 8. And every day you win because you're up at 7:45. So you're actually early. And she's like, I can totally do that. And I'm like, okay, so listen. Yeah. Self-sabotage. Oh, it is. But until you bring awareness that these kind of patterns are happening, it's really difficult to break them.
Yeah.
And that's why coaching or mentors or masterminds or whatever are so important, because they, like, I listen for patterns. I listen for the things that they say or they do that are recurring. My clients today, they know what they need to do. And they basically do what I call smooshing through the day. It's like, blah, blah, blah. They kind of do bits and pieces of this, but at the end of the day, they've wasted time and they're wondering what they've done with their lives, right? So very simply, I've got a planner that I send all my clients and I'm like, let me introduce you to time blocking. So you're going to take all the things that you know you need to do. Instead of just sort of like off the top of your head trying to get it done, you're going to say from 9 to 10, I'm going to do this. Then I'm going to have scatter thoughts for half an hour. And I'm maybe from, you know, 11 to 12, I'll do another thing. Right. And so you become more intentional with your time. And that stops the sort of wasting time, not really focusing, shiny penny syndrome that a lot of people suffer from. So most often, to answer your question very directly, it's self-sabotage that stop people. And that can be habits, mindsets, your support network or lack thereof, or toxic people. It could be you've picked the wrong model, but you're trying to shoehorn it to work when you really shouldn't, because it's like me and my agency, it was the wrong model for what I really, really wanted to do. Like the work I can do now, I'll work till I'm 90. I don't care. I love this stuff, right? Whereas the agency, I was like, TikTok, TikTok, how much longer do I have to do this? When you get into that kind of a thought, like, you know you need to do something. It's just sometimes it's not always clear what that should be. And that's kind of hard to unravel by yourself.
Yeah. And I think just the example that you gave of the client of yours who always woke up at 7:45, but thought she was supposed to get up, felt like she should be getting up at 7, and feeling like a failure as soon as she got out of bed. I'm not even sure that consciously she thought that she was feeling like a failure, but absolutely you would, because the first thing you wanted to do today and you're already behind the eight ball.
Right. And then that takes you through the whole day. Right. And so you're already behind. You're already behind. And if you do that consistently, you feel like you never catch up. Because the other thing that often people will do, entrepreneurs in particular, is they'll say, like, I want to make just $100,000 a year. And they will purposely not hit that. And that sounds so strange. But when you think about it, a lot of them fear getting there and then not staying there. What if I don't make it? What if I go to 95 the year after that? What if I just go up and then I come right back down again? And so to avoid that feeling of failure, they don't try. Because if I don't try, you know, I can just say, what could have been? And that is fixed mindset thinking. I could have been great. I could have done this. I could have done that. But they sit in their cute little label of could-haves, right? Could-haves and should-haves. But they don't. But it's not failure because they didn't actually fail. They didn't try, so it's not failure. But it's really not anything, and it becomes very unsettling. And that's the people, some people live there all their lives. And that very unsettling feeling of never really gone, never really done anything, never really pushed themselves hard enough. And then there's other people, they'll sit in that for a while and go, I don't like this anymore. I want out. And that's if they can, if they have a coach or they learn somehow to say, what am I going to learn from my situation and how I'm going to get the heck out of Dodge, right? Then they can learn their way out of it and train themselves into the life that they want. It's just training. It's nothing to do with how smart you are, where your education level, woman, man, you know, what color your skin is, what country you're from, when you were born, where you, like, it doesn't, none of those correlate to high performance. And this is like a statistically proven study that was done on what habits lead to long-term income growth, happiness, confidence, success, how you perceive yourself and your peers. Like, there's really high standard deviations of like positive correlations with these habits that I teach and generating those long-term results. Because a lot of coaches can be flash in the pan or they try to create a dependency. Those are not the coaches you want. You want coaches that teach you that even it's a matter of 90 days long. So my whole thing is, if after 90 days you want to keep going because like we're having a great time, sweet. But my goal is after the 90 days, you don't need me anymore. You only need yourself because there's no one else in the world that can motivate and create the results that you want, and you're enough. And that one message, you're enough, cannot be said enough. Like, because so many people struggle with that not enough mentality.
And that is so different from what most coaching programs are. They're not designed, you know, they want you to work with them over and over and over, month after month, year after year. So very different. So I know Steve has a bunch of questions and I keep cutting them off. Can you tell everyone in our audience the name of your book again? Is it out? Are they able to buy it, and where would they be able to buy it?
Sure. So it's called Think Again, My 7-Stage Journey from Self-Sabotage to Success. You can get it at thinkagainbook.com. Or if you prefer Amazon, you can get it there too. So it actually hit number one in 6 countries in 8 personal development and success categories after it launched. So it's been a really awesome journey. It's a self-help book in a way to identify areas of self-sabotage. But then the latter part of the book is, and now what do you do with it? Now that you've had that clarity, where are you going from here? So there's strategies, there are business models that you can apply to your business. There are support network strategies on how you surround yourself with people who are going to take you there. So that's where the book has been a labor of love. And that book was, once upon a time, it was a sticky and it just said book.
Absolutely. That's great. And I really do hate to start drawing this to an end. It's been great. If you will have us, we'll love to have you back on the show again at some time, because I think Juliet was right. I have a list of questions here that we didn't even get to. But out of respect, no, it's been awesome. Out of respect for your time and for our audience, I am going to start winding it down. And that brings us to our smart man, smarter woman version of James Lipton's Q&A from Actor Studio, where we ask our list of questions. We ask every guest the same questions. And if you are ready, I would like to begin.
Set, go.
Awesome. What one word best defines an entrepreneur?
Freedom.
What profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
Oh, other than my own? So are we talking like if nothing was an object?
It's wide open.
I love like storm chasing. That stuff's fun.
Okay. We have not had anyone give that answer before. What profession would you like never to attempt?
Coder. My ADD would go nuts.
Okay. What sound or noise do you love?
My husband's voice.
Okay. What book would you recommend every entrepreneur must read?
The Four Agreements by Don Miguel Ruiz.
Interesting. Okay. A guest that we had on either 1 week ago or 2 weeks ago gave the same book, and I'd never heard of it. And now I've heard it twice in the same book.
Phenomenal. Phenomenal. Game changer. Changed my life. It started me down the path of like being able to handle those big, massive mindset problems I have coming out of my cult. It was the one thing that helped me. It started my healing process far and away.
Awesome. So obviously we need to read that book, Julia. The universe is speaking to
it
us.
It is.
When your own entrepreneurial journey is completed, what do you hope your legacy is?
That I have helped as many people live happier, wealthier, more fulfilled lives.
Awesome. And would you like, I guess the first thing, anyone in our audience who wants to connect with you, what is the best way for them to do that?
My website, which is rebeccamountain.ca.
Okay. And I will spell that because Rebecca can be spelled several ways. It is Rebecca and mountain is a mountain.
Big hill, snow, bears.
There you go. And do you have any final words to conclude our episode that you would like to share with our audience of entrepreneurs, Rebecca?
There's no such thing as an entrepreneurial deficiency. There is only entrepreneurial learning and training that needs to happen, and that it cannot be done alone. And that's not just because I'm a coach. I get my own coaches. I mean, I've paid upward of $60,000 US for my coaches for just 1 year. But that 60,000, I turned into 500,000. So as long as you do something with the coaching you have, then you have, it's been a good experience.
Awesome. And what about you, Juliet? Do you have any final words you would like to say before we close out?
No, I'm going to go and get Rebecca's book because I've not read it. Because she was talking to me, I could hear, it was like she was sitting there and kind of sitting on the sidelines of my life. So yeah, definitely.
Awesome. And that brings us to our words of wisdom from me, the quote nerd. I love quotes. So for this episode, I chose peace is the result of retraining your mind to process life as it is, rather than as you think it should be. Wayne Dyer.
Love that guy.
Yep. Great quote. And thank you again, Rebecca. You, as I knew you would be, you were awesome. It was very, very good. Lots of stuff there for our audience. Thank you again to my awesome co-host. Couldn't do this without you. And most importantly, thank you to you, our audience, for tuning in and giving us a listen. We sincerely hope you found some value here today, and I'm sure you did. If you like, we would love it if you would subscribe to the podcast. We're in all the usual places, iTunes, Spotify, Google, or you can visit the website, smartmansmarterwoman.com. Give us a listen. So thank you again. Until next time, take good care of yourself and those that you love. Bye for now.